back here with Chris Bosh. We're going viral. KD, Kevin Durant went down with his Achilles injury back in game 5 of the NBA Finals last year. And with the Raptors going on to win the title, KD explains to Toronto center Serge Ibaka how things would have been different had he not gotten injured.
Let's put it like this. If y'all go into a game 7 with a 2-time champ, y'all not winning that game. Y'all not. I mean, y'all had to win in 6, which y'all did. But if I was out there, y'all wouldn't have won.
No, first
at
of
home.
All, if you didn't.
Y'all wouldn't have beat us at home.
We almost beat you guys at 5. You know that, right?
Yeah, y'all almost. All right. I'm talking about game 6.
Okay.
Y'all almost lost anyway. Clay went out and y'all almost lost. So game 6, we just smacked y'all at the crib. And then game 7, I know for sure y'all wouldn't have, you could have heard a pin drop in y'all locker room in game 7 walking into that arena. Like, y'all would have been so shook.
KD makes a really good point because we all know the Warriors could never lose a game 7 at home for the NBA Finals. We all, I mean, that could never happen. Never would happen, never has happened. I mean, it was so obviously.
But KD was like, I wasn't with him.
No. KD had lost the game 7 the round before to those Warriors.
Oh, but this is
that's
different.
Just, yeah, that's two friends having a conversation, and you know how it is.
I love
it. Like, look, we that wouldn't have happened. Surges, they're both right. Going to tell you each reason why they were going to win.
More importantly, go ahead.
No, please.
No, please. You won't like what I had to say.
Okay. How many of those had you had with the Spurs?
It was too serious.
Oh.
Yeah, we never talked.
Oh.
Yeah, we never talked about it. It was just like, man, congratulations. I know it stung. It stung for us, too. And
okay.
That was it.
Respect.
Yeah, just keep on moving, man.
Ibaka's show is awesome.
Is it a baking show?
It's a cooking show. He had KD eat snake there, which there's a little double entendre because KD was called a snake by
right.
Russ.
Then they had cupcakes snake. For dessert.
Yeah, the whole
thing, but
it's a fun shot.
Yeah. After an NBA offseason of predictions and prognostications about who the best team in LA really is tonight, we will get our first look. The NBA season tips off with a much anticipated matchup between the Lakers and the Clippers. Two biggest winners of the offseason, two teams with the best two odds to win the NBA title. LeBron is entering his 17th season, but he's still as excited as ever.
Opening night is great. This for me, it's like the first day of school. The first day of school, going back to school. Laying your clothes out the night before, just that excitement of getting the thing back going. I mean, I love to play the game, and obviously, I had the longest layoff of my career. So, to be where I'm at physically, mentally, no matter who we opened up against, I think for TV, for you guys, for everybody that you know. Part of y'all's job to, be hype beast. Tuesday is a great day.
Why?
It's just like he's shocked. Like your high school games were on TV.
Yeah.
You haven't gotten used to TV yet, bro.
Hey, Chris Bosh, are you buying the Clippers as favorites to win the title ahead of tonight's matchup with the Lakers?
I'm not. I don't think they're the favorites to win. I think they have a tremendous team, but I think we were talking about it earlier with Paul George's shoulder surgeries. Him not being able to play the first 10 games of the season at the very least, missing the whole preseason, those things are very, very important. Preseason is very, very important in getting in shape. You're not going to see, I don't think you're going to see him really get into his groove until February, maybe even March. It takes a whole season to come together, and they have a new team, new coaching situation. You have to gel together. It takes time for all that stuff, and I think it's just going to be too much time or not enough time in between him coming back, them figuring it out, and then they have to kind of reshuffle the deck because he's a great player once he comes back. So I think it's going to be fascinating just to see how they recoup, in their situation. But, I mean, another injury, it's just it's tough. And if you're going to be the title favorites, Chris, you got to be healthy.
Mm-hmm.
That's number one first and foremost. It might play out in the long run. It might be great for them. But for right now, I think being in that Western Conference, you've got to hit the ground running.
Yeah, I know we're reshuffling the deck as far as the NBA. It's not about three anymore. It's about duets. And when you guys came together individually, Dwayne Wade, a champion, LeBron coming from Cleveland, and you from Toronto, one thing they don't talk about as we get ready for the NBA season is sacrifice. Philadelphia Eagles, they might be the most talented team in the NFL, but we don't have the players sacrificing for one another, so they're a great team on paper alone. What about the Clippers and coming together? And you made more sacrifices. I've heard Dwayne Wade talk about it. LeBron has talked about it. No one's game suffered or had to adjust more than yourself. How important is that for the Clippers and that adjustment? Because guys are used to playing their role, and Doc, how does he communicate that to them?
Well, I mean, I think one of the biggest adjustments is going to have to be Lou Will. You know, he's always sixth man of the year candidate every year, but he's used to coming in and getting buckets right away. Now, with Paul George out for the first few weeks, he's going to be able to operate. I think they'll be able to figure out a way to score points because he's that talented and that great. But when you get a great player coming back, it's only one ball, and you have to share it, and you have to make sure you get guys open. So those small things are going to be super necessary with their players setting screens, getting back on defense, being on time, you know, having good leadership, you know, and they have a, you know, they have a veteran savvy team. But I tell you one thing, they're going to be scary on the defensive end. They're going to be very exciting.
Yes.
And either way, if they're the favorite or not, they're going to be right there when it's winning time.
But before we get to the Lakers, my concern with the Clippers, you explained very, very well. And I think when you look at the West, you've got five teams plus the Warriors lurking that believe they can win the title. Denver was right there as close as they've been as a franchise, hell, since Melo was playing there and they took Kobe to the six in the Western Conference Finals. Utah has as good of a 1-5 starting lineup as any team in the league. We obviously know the Rockets are all in once again, the Lakers and the Clippers. Two of those teams are playing each other in the first round. One of those teams is gone in the first round, which is why the regular season takes on an air of extra importance because being one of those top three seeds, and by the way, even if you're the third seed, you might be facing a Warriors team that has Klay coming back. Mm-hmm. So maybe being one of those top two seeds. I don't think the Clippers can be that. I don't think they can be that because they're going to be without Paul George. But they're saying 10 games, man. Like, if they're saying 10, I would expect 15.
And you got to shake the rust
and
off.
All of that. So now to the Lakers part of it. Now, the Lakers obviously have a totally new roster as well. As far as, I think Kuzma is the only guy left of the rotation players from when LeBron got there.
Yeah.
So it is a totally new team. But the LeBron-Anthony Davis fit, to me, is hand in glove to a degree. How do you see that fitting instantly, and how much of a work in progress do you believe it's going to be?
It's not going to take that long.
Yeah.
I think they're already off to a good start. They're so talented and so great at what they do. You just throw them out there, and that'll take care of itself. I think the parts that they feel that nobody's really talking about is the genius level IQ talent that they have. Danny Green, Rajon Rondo, Avery Bradley, been very good, has a lot of playoff experience.
Yes.
You know, Dwight Howard, number one pick. You know, he's trying to redeem himself in the league. That's going to be huge for them because he's coming in against second team bigs.
Guys.
And, you know, he's a former first-round pick, been to the finals, has playoff experience. So I think there'll be, and JaVale McGee as well, rim protection. He's got championships as well. So it's a very, kind of an underrated thing. They're kind of flying under the radar. I guess it's crazy to say. They're flying under the radar a little bit as far as their IQ is concerned. They have a very high-level IQ.
KCP is the other play. Kuzma KCP. And KCP are the two guys that predate LeBron.
Sure.
Go ahead.
As far as the Lakers go, how important is it for them to treat this season like a marathon? Not come out too strong, not come out too hard. LeBron had a legit offseason for the first time. He's got actual veterans around him. How important is it going to be, Chris, for them to come out and pace themselves so that they are available in May, in April, you know, so that they're all healthy and available?
It's kind of this weird thing in the league. You want to pace yourself, but you want to go at a nice pace. You know, you don't want to say,
what does that look like?
You know, we're going to be fine. I don't, you know, it changes every season. I think in the Lakers situation, they're very deep. Bron's fresh. Mm-hmm. He's had a whole offseason, which hasn't happened in a very long time. You know, he's talking about the first day of school and moving back and forth. He's very excited. But like we were saying, alluding to with the Western Conference, it's going to be more of a sprint than a marathon, as crazy as that sounds.
Yes.
Because every game is going to be important. And, you know, if you're not in that top four, even if you're the number one or number two seed, you might have to play two games in San Antonio.
Right.
You know, and that's not an easy place to play. So, you know, I think they're going to have to find their balance, but at the same time, they're ready to go.
Yeah, I don't think load management is going to be a much of a key this year, even though we are going to have some teams that are going to have to watch their players. Because NBA players, if I do know one thing, they watch NBA TV. They watch the games, and they will be looking at that, oh, what's the record? So to me, I'm like you. It's not going to be a marathon. You're going to have to run at a quick pace. We saw the guy break 2 hours at the marathon.
In the actual marathon.
This year in the NBA, that load management, be careful. The Clippers, they can get themselves into a situation with Denver, Utah. All these guys got young rosters that they don't have the same questions as far as load management, and they're putting pretty much a healthy young roster out there every night.
And real quick, the NBA tries to backload its schedule for its best teams for after football, so for television reasons. If you look at the Lakers, the softest part of the Lakers' schedule, aside from tonight, is these opening 6 weeks. They have to get out to a good start. Like, there's not going to be any, the Lakers are in fifth place the trade deadline, and they're going to climb from there. The schedule gets brutal for them as far as playing marquee matchup after marquee matchup late in the season. They've got it, to me, get off to something like 20-7 to start the season if they're going to be positioned well for the type of seed they want.
Chris Bosh, thanks for hanging out with us. You're back here tomorrow.
Yeah.
Really?
Tomorrow.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Sounds great. Take a break. Coming up, Tom Brady and the Patriots just traded for a new weapon. Next, no person
first. It's the first day of school. I typically didn't have new clothes.